Today we will continue to talk about GIT ultrasound. We will talk about inflammatory diseases affecting the GIT and how it appears by ultrasound. To start with acute appendicitis. Appendicitis is a common disease in all periods of life. However, it is most frequently occurs in children and adolescents. Ultrasound examination of the appendix usually needs a graded compression technique because it could be masked by gases, which could be slightly difficult because of the tenderness associated with this technique. Coronary appendicitis, if this term is actually present, it usually does not affect the size and shape of the appendix, so it is usually cannot be diagnosed by imaging. So we'll neglect this image. It is a controversial term, however it is present or not, whatever, it cannot be diagnosed by imaging, including the ultrasound. The normal ultrasound appearance of the appendix, the anterior diameter is normally less than 6 millimeters. No peristalsis is visualized in the normal appendix. The appendix is compressible with ovoid configuration in the transverse section with compression. This is an example of a normal appearing appendix in TS and LS. Is rounded. If it is compressed, it will be ovoid. Can be ovoid without compression, and this is the LS. This is an example of compressibility of the appendix. This is appendix without compression, and with compression, it becomes ovoid in shape. In acute appendicitis, ultrasound findings include if diameter more than 6 millimeters, loss of compressibility, no gas inside, appendicitis, tenderness, and hypervascularized wall. The first two findings are the most important ones. The remaining ones may be or may not be present. Another finding is in the surrounding tissues, not in the appendix itself, can be altered periappendicular fat, related lymphadenopathy, related fluid, related dilated fluid-filled bowel loops, and second related peritoneum. The example of acutely inflamed appendix and appendicitis in the wall is second hypochoic and hypervascular. The surrounding mesentery or fat within the surrounding mesentery is hyperechoic. Another example is the second wall of the appendix. This is the LS of the appendix. This is the TS, is also second hypervascularized, and there are multiple related lymph nodes. This is a minimal rim of fluid here. Another example, LS of the appendix, second hypochoic wall, also in transverse image, hypervascularity within the wall, fluid and lymph nodes, and the surrounding fat within the mesentery is heterogeneous and hyperechoic. Another example, also the appendix is second with appendicitis, an heterogeneous structure within the lumen of the appendix here and appears here with posterior shadowing. Another example, dilated bowel loops with turbid fluid and heterogeneous fat within the mesentery and the bowel loops are dilated. And this is the second peritoneum. We cannot assess the thickness of the peritoneum unless there is a sizable amount of fluid in order to be able to see the second peritoneum. Complications of acute appendicitis include appendicular mass and the appendicular abscess formation. Appendicular mass or phlegmon is usually seen in patients who are admitted with considerable delay. Ultrasound shows a large mass of non-compressible fat around the appendix and interspersed with echolucent streaks. It is managed conservatively. This is why it is important to diagnose it by ultrasound, because acute appendicitis is an indication for surgery. However, appendicular mass is an indication for conservative management. This is an example of appendicular mass. This is a large mass-like structure formed mainly of fat surrounding the appendix, the inflamed appendix. This is also another example in another patient, mass like lesion of mainly of fat around inflamed appendix, as there is minimal fluid inside. However, appendicular abscess, the collection often contains air and is surrounded by inflamed non-compressible hyperechoic tissue representing the omentum and the mesentery, as well as the second neighboring bowel lobes attempting to seal off the abscess from the peritoneal cavity. This is the inflamed appendix, and this is the fluid collection related to it, contains air bubbles giving these hyperechoic dots. This is an example of an abscess. Another example of an abscess with hyperechoic small dots representing the air inside this fluid collection. This is surrounded by inflamed fat, maybe bowel loops. What are the differential diagnoses of acute appendicitis, mesenteric lymphadenitis, epiploid appendicitis, omental infarction, terminal ileitis, rectus hematoma, and others such as renal gynecological causes? The last item is beyond the scope of this lecture. We will not discuss the renal or gynecological causes of differential diagnosis of acute appendicitis. Mesenteric lymphadenitis, lymph nodes with absence of any other findings. Enlarged lymph nodes are more than 10 mm in long axis or more than 4 mm in short axis, multiple lymph nodes without any other findings of acute appendicitis. In rectus sheath hematoma, the patient usually under anticoagulant therapy with rectus sheath fluid collection. This is the rectus sheath and this is the fluid collection within the rectus sheath. This is the skin and subcutaneous tissue. It is very superficial and can be seen easily by ultrasound. In epiploid appendicitis, due to torsion and secondary inflammation of the epiploid appendage, ultrasound shows inflamed fatty mass adjacent to the colon. This is the colon and this is a fatty mass inflamed surrounded by minimal fluid, but we will not see the appendix with the second wall and all the other findings. Omental infarction, the ultrasound shows a cake-like inflamed fatty mass larger than in epiploid appendicitis. This is a fat inflamed fat forming a mass-like lesion. But also the other findings of acute appendicitis are missing. In terminal ileitis, for example, in Crohn's disease, one-third of the patients are presented by acute attack resembling appendicitis. Ultrasound shows transmural bowel wall thickening, often predominantly of the submucosal layer, with frequent inflammatory changes of the surrounding fat. The appendix may be involved, as in this example, but also the terminal ileum is almost always involved. And this is the second wall of the appendix, but the terminal ileum is also involved, not only the appendix. Another item concerning the appendix is the mucocele of the appendix. It occurs when there is an abnormal accumulation of mucin, causing abnormal distension of the appendix due to various neoplastic or non-neoplastic causes. Causes include mucus retention cysts due to obstruction, most commonly by appendiculus, mucosal hyperplasia, mucinous cyst adenoma, which is the most common cause, and mucinous adenocarcinoma. Of course, this is the most dangerous cause. In mucocele of the appendix, ultrasound shows cystic mass with variable internal echogenesis. What's called onion sign means layering within a cystic mass. Acoustic shadowing may be present due to the mural calcifications. This is an example of mucocele of the appendix. The appendix is markedly distended with variable internal echogenesis, giving the onion peel sign appearance. Coming to another entity of inflammatory disease affecting the GIT, which is the Crohn's disease. It's a chronic granulomatous inflammatory condition of the GIT. It is characterized by a segmental and transmural inflammation of the intestinal wall, particularly the ileum in 30% of cases, colon in 20%, or both large and small bowel in 50% of cases. Mucosal abnormality consists of ulcerations which may penetrate the wall, creating fissures and fistulae, and causing intra-abdominal or retroperitoneal abscesses. Mesentery is often thickened and fatty, surrounding the thickened walls and containing enlarged lymph node. This is called creeping fat, thickened fat in the mesentery. What are the applications of ultrasound as regarding Crohn's disease, early diagnosis of the disease? But in fact, the findings of ultrasound in Crohn's disease are not so specific to diagnose Crohn's disease, but it can point or suggest the diagnosis, but final diagnosis needs tissue biopsy by colonoscope or something like that. But the more important rule is follow-up and to detect intra-abdominal complications such as stretcher, fistulae, and abscess, and to assess and to monitor the course of disease and response to therapy. What are the ultrasound findings in the Crohn's disease? Findings in the intestinal wall, intestine itself, is bowel wall thickening, alteration of the bowel wall echo pattern, hyperemia or hypervascularity, loss of elasticity and peristalsis, mesenteric hypertrophy and mesenteric lymph nodes. But we can also find intra-abdominal complications of Crohn's disease include stenosis, obstruction, sinus tracts and fistulae, inflammatory masses such as phlegm or abscess formation. As regarding bowel wall thickening, the wall thickness is measured in a transverse section from the central hyperechoic line to the outer hyperechoic margin of the wall. Thickness of the thickened bowel walls means more than 4 mm. This is an example of thickened bowel wall. This is the measurements from the inner hyperechoic line to the outer hyperechoic line should not exceed 4 mm in normal intestine. This is another example. This is the cursor here and cursor here to measure the thickness in TS. It is more accurate to measure it in TS. Alteration of bowel wall echo pattern. If stratification is maintained, the thickened walls display a variable enlargement of the mucosal, submucosal, or muscle layers. The submucosa is usually thicker than the others. This is an example of thickened bowel wall with maintained stratification or layering of the wall, and another example of thickened bowel loop with nearly lost stratification, especially in the far wall. The layering is difficult to identify. This is a hypoechoic. The wall is almost completely hypoechoic. Another example of thickened bowel wall with maintained layering in TS here and LS here. The submucosa, which is the hyperechoic layer here, is thickened, and also here is thickened, thicker than the other layers. The stratification may be interrupted by hypoechoic areas or hyperechoic spots denoting ulcers, or the stratification may completely disappear, what is called the hypoechoic echo pattern, which is correlated with more severe inflammation. This is interrupted stratification of the wall by hypoechoic fissures or ulcers. Here another example with TS, this is LS. There is in this image a small fissure, hypoechoic line crossing the wall, interrupting the stratification of the wall. This is complete loss of stratification of the wall, which is called hypoechoic pattern or hypoechoic echo pattern of the bowel wall. Hyperemia, the increased vascularity is often observed in bowel wall with decreased echogenicity. Vascularity within the thickened bowel walls assessed by color and power Doppler ultrasound is used to as an index of Crohn's disease activity. Vascularity is evaluated using a simple semi-quantitative scoring system by categorizing it into mild, moderate, and severe, or by using Doppler indices as resistive index obtained from the vessels detected within the bowel wall itself. This is an example of severe hyperemia or hypervascularity of the bowel wall, marked hyperemia. The thickened bowel wall in Crohn's disease are usually associated with a reduction or absence of peristalsis in the small bowel and loss of restorations in the colon. With enteric hypertrophy and lymph nodes, fibrofatty proliferation in the mesentery, which is called creeping fat, appears as a hyperechoic inhomogeneous area surrounding the second bowel walls. Enlarged mesenteric lymph nodes appear as oval, homogeneous hypoechoic nodules with central fatty hilum with regular margins. This is an example of enlarged mesenteric lymph nodes with the central fatty hilum and the hypoechoic peripheral cortex. Bowel stenosis can be revealed by ultrasound as thickened bowel wall associated with narrowed lumen and increased diameter of the proximal loops to be more than 2.5 to 3 cm. Acute stenosis are often associated with a variable amount of liquid and gas within the lumen of the proximal loops and with increased peristalsis. However, in chronic incomplete stenosis, the amount of air within the proximal loop prevails and peristalsis is usually weak. Loss of stratification of the bowel wall at the level of the stricture suggests its inflammatory nature with a lower degree of fibrosis. However, the presence of the stratification suggests a higher degree of fibrosis as the stenosis. The example of a hypoechoic strictured bowel segment with proximal with dilatation of the proximal bowel loops containing air and fluid. This is the bowel, the proximal bowel loops are dilated, containing fluid and air. This is a stretched segment is hypoechoic, denoting inflammatory nature with small with less degree of fibrosis. Another example, also the bowel wall is stretched hypoechoic with proximal dilatation. Also, the bowel wall is stretched narrowed lumen with proximal dilatation. This, in chronic stenosis, this stretched bowel segment maintains its stratification with air predominates in the proximally dilated bowel loops. This means higher degree of fibrosis of this segment and this chronic nature of the stenosis, chronic incomplete stenosis. Sinus stress and fistula are complications of Crohn's disease. They may end blindly in the surrounding mesentery or connects intestinal loops or adjacent organs. Depending on their site and extension, abdominal fistulae are commonly subdivided into external, we mean enterocutaneous, or internal, such as enteroenteric or enteromesenteric or enterovesical. Fistulae may appear on ultrasound as hypoechoic ducts or areas between intestinal loops or between loops and other structures such as the bladder enterovesical fistula or the stain intercutaneous fistula. Fistulae may display internal echogenic spots due to the presence of air debris or intestinal material. This is an example of enteromesenteric fistula, a short fistula and ends blindly within the mesentery. Enterovesical fistula connects the bowel loops to the urinary bladder and protruding within the lumen in the of the bladder, enterovesical fistula. Enteroenteric fistula is connects two bowel loops together. This is hypoechoic fistula. Another example of enteroenteric fistula with small abscess formation. This is the abscess formation, and this is bowel loop and another bowel loop connected together by the fistula. An example of enterocutaneous, this is the bowel loop and this is the fistula connecting it to the skin surface, traversing the abdominal wall with hyperemia and the internal echoes within the fistula representing the air debris or intestinal contents. Intra-abdominal abscesses and inflammatory masses usually occur as a consequence of fistulizing disease or as a post-surgical complications. Abscesses appear as hypoechoic lesions with fluid collection containing internal echoes and irregular second wall and may show posterior acoustic enhancement. This is an example of an abscess. Another example of an abscess collection resulting from a fistula here. And this is the fluid collection representing the abscess. Another example, this is an fistula or sinus tract here and causing fluid collection, what meaning abscess formation. This is another abscess, fluid collection with second wall and different epigenesis, variable epigenesis within. Coming to another entity of the inflammatory disease affecting the bowel, which is ulcerative colitis. The role of ultrasound in ulcerative colitis is less than in Crohn's disease, as in ulcerative colitis, inflammatory lesions are confined to the colon, especially the rectum, which is considered difficult to be imaged by ultrasound and affect only the inner wall layer of the colon in most of the cases. Ulcerative colitis involves the rectum and extends proximally to all or different portions of the colon, ulcerative portitis, sigmoiditis, left-sided colitis, or pancolitis, according to the severity of the disease. Proximal spread of the disease occurs in continuity without areas of uninvolved mucosa. Mucosal inflammation of the internal ileum, the so-called backwash ileitis, is rare. Insufficient distension of the bowel lumen may lead to underestimation of disease by ultrasound in case of ulcerative colitis. So we can use what is called small bowel contrast ultrasound, which may help in detection of superficial pathologies. What do we mean by small bowel contrast ultrasound? Is ultrasound examination 45 minutes after injection of 600 milliliters of an isoosmolar solution containing a non-digestible, non-absorbable, non-fermentable hydrophilic macromolecule such as polyethylene glycol? What is the ultrasound findings in case of ulcerative colitis? Superficial ulcerations, bowel wall thickening, alteration of bowel wall echo pattern, loss of hysterations, hyperemia, mesenteric hypertrophy and lymph nodes, and complications such as pseudobulbosis or toxic mediacolon. Superficial ulcerations may appear usually on small bowel contrast ultrasound as irregular mucosa with fine hyperechoic spots. As in this example, this is the bowel wall and this is the ulcerated surface appears hyperechoic. This is an example by small bowel contrast ultrasound. The lumen is distended to ensure more reliable detection of superficial pathology. Bowel thickening in active ulcerative colitis patients, ultrasound reveals second bowel walls, usually more than 4 mm, frequently ranging between 5 and 7 mm. Rarely it reaches 10 mm in the most severe disease grades. It is regular, symmetrical, continuous, and predominates in the left colon. It's an example of second bowel wall, which is continuous, symmetrical, and regular bowel wall thickening. Another example, TS and LS. Also, this is an example of second bowel wall. Usually, for instance, submucosa and submucosa with the sparing of the muscle layer. The muscle layer is appears thin, not so thickened as the submucosa and mucosa. Also, thickened bowel wall with maintained stratification yet with loss of hysterations. No hysterations appeared in this bowel wall segment of the colon. Alteration of bowel wall echo pattern. Since inflammation involves the mucosa and superficial submucosa, so the stratified echo pattern of the bowel wall is usually preserved. However, in cases of acute severe inflammation, the thickening involves the submucosa, which may appear slightly hypochoic and heterogeneous, causing loss of stratification and increased bowel wall vascularity. The example, second bowel wall with loss of stratification as compared to a bowel wall with normal stratification. Cause of second bowel wall with loss of stratification and with increased vascularity, markedly increased vascularity. Loss of stratification is a frequent finding in active and extensive disease. Is an example of loss of stratification, bowel wall thickened to hypochoic. To a lesser extent, hypochoic stratification is partially preserved, yet the hysteration is absent as compared to the normal hysterations in a normal bowel loop. Pseudobulbosis. Pseudobulbs are seen as small epigenetic nodules visible at the surface of the mucosa or epigenetic indentations into the fluid-filled intestinal mucosa. Also, usually more easy to be detected in small bowel contrast ultrasound. As in this example, this is the lumen is distended. This is a superficial ulceration as we see before. This is hyperacute line and the irregularity represents the superficial ulceration. This is a second bowel wall and this is a pseudopolyp, inflammatory polyp protruding into the lumen. In case of extensive pseudobulbosis, it appears as increased and heterogeneous thickness of the bowel wall up to 15 mm without the typical wall stratification, markedly irregular internal margins and or as dilated non-compressible bowel with echogenic heterogeneous contents. This is in TS and this is LS, markedly thickened bowel with heterogeneous lumen. And this is the LS, the inner margin is irregular and heterogeneous and is non-compressible. Of course, this is appears in real-time ultrasound. In thoracic media colon, the presence of thoracic media colon should be suspected when marked decrease in thickness of the wall less than 2 mm of the colonic wall associated with dilatation more than 6 cm of the transverse colon and the presence of fluid-filled dilated ileal loops. As in this example, the diameter is more than 6 cm of the transverse colon, the wall thickness is less than 2 mm. Dilated ileal bowel loops with fluid in between, and this is the characteristic X-ray appearance of the thoracic media colon. This is an emergency situation and should be suspected if these findings are present. We come to the end of this lecture, but we will continue, inshallah, to discuss other inflammatory conditions affecting the GIT in the next lecture. Thank you.